Welcome to Bot Hostage Diplomacy. We work to free hostages and the unjustly detained around the world. Together with their families, we share their stories and let you know how you can help bring them home.
Now, when it comes to using the family to get for Russia to get what they want, if that's the case, they've picked the wrong family, because I'm not going to carry water for the Russian authorities.
These are some of the most courageous and resilient people among us.
I never thought that my mother, Nahi Tagavi, will ever have a link to negotiations in Vienna about the JCPOA. That's so crazy.
People who have never given up hope.
Trevor told his girlfriend to tell me to be strong. So I'm trying to be strong for Trevor.
You know, if Trevor can cope with what he's dealing with,
exactly,
we can sure cope with the stress.
People who will never stop working to reunite their families.
We'd like to meet with the president. We believe that, you know, he's surrounded by lots of experienced and educated advisors. But I don't believe that any of them have ever had a child taken hostage by a foreign country, especially not a superpower like Russia.
And we'll be right there by their side until their loved one comes back home.
Because if enough people care, then the right people will care enough.
I'm Darren Nair, and I've been campaigning with many of these families for years. When I first started campaigning with these families, I noticed they struggled to get the media attention they needed. So I decided to create this podcast, which is a safe space for the families to speak as long as they need to about their loved ones and what needs to be done to bring them home.
Nobody can prepare you for what our family is going through. Even if someone had told me 1 year before, in 1 year this is going to happen, prepare yourself. That's impossible.
Thank you for listening, and welcome to Bot Hostage Diplomacy. Welcome to Bot Hostage Diplomacy. French citizen Cécile Kohler has been wrongfully imprisoned in Iran since 7 May 2022. She and her partner, Jacques Paris, were both arrested on their way to the airport after visiting Iran as tourists and have been held in Iran since. The French government has referred to them as state hostages. In October 2022, both Cécile and Jacques were made to deliver false confessions, which were aired on Iranian state media. This is sadly a common practice in Iran, as the regime is notorious for arresting innocent foreign nationals on trumped-up charges, placing them in solitary confinement, interrogating them for hours, depriving them of access to legal counsel and medication, as well as forcing them to confess to things that they didn't do. After all that, they are then sentenced to years in prison in a sham trial for a crime they didn't commit. In response to these false confessions, the French Foreign Ministry released the following statement on 6 October 2022. Cécile Kohler and Jacques Paris have been arbitrarily detained in Iran since May 2022 and can therefore be considered state hostages. France reiterates its demand for their immediate release. We demand immediate, unconditional access to our two compatriots in accordance with the international obligations to which Iran subscribed under the Vienna Convention of April 24, 1963. The staging of their supposed confessions is unworthy, repugnant, unacceptable, and contrary to international law. This farce reveals the Iranian authorities' contempt for human dignity. These supposed confessions, extorted under duress, have no basis in fact, any more than do the reasons given for their arbitrary arrest. France vigorously condemns the Iranian regime's inhumane, unworthy treatment of our compatriots. We hold the Iranian authorities responsible for their fate and their treatment, and for that of all French nationals currently being detained arbitrarily in Iran. Such manipulation and practices, worthy of the sure trials of the worst dictatorial regimes, will not deflect international attention from the legitimate aspirations of the Iranian people. The French authorities remain wholeheartedly committed to obtaining their release and providing support for their families and loved ones. That was a statement from the French Foreign Ministry. Today, we have the honor of speaking to Cécile Kohler's sister, Noémie Kohler, who is speaking to us from France. Noémie, we're so sorry for what you, your sister, Jacques, and your family are going through. Thank you for taking the time to speak to us today.
Thank you very much for receiving me.
You're very welcome. So first of all, can you please walk us through your sister's background and why she went to Iran?
Yes, my sister Cécile was 37 when she went to Iran. She is a French teacher and unionist. She has been dreaming of visiting Iran for, I don't know, like 15 years, something like this. She went to Iran for the first time with her partner, Jacques Paris. And it was the first time. She was very happy, very glad to be in Iran. She was sending us a picture of her trip all the day, every day. And she was very happy. She was supposed to stay there for 10 days during vacation, school holidays, you know, French school holidays. And she was supposed to stay for 10 days, but at the end of her trip, she and her partner were arrested. And so from then, they are in Iran, in prison.
Sorry to hear that, Noemi. What happened from the moment of your sister's arrest? As in, when and how did you find out she was arrested, and what did you and your family do next?
Well, the last WhatsApp connection of her phone was the 6th of May of 2002. And we didn't get any news from then. And after the weekend, we were very concerned. And we had a message, a call from her colleagues saying that she didn't go back to work. So we were very concerned. My parents called the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, and then they got the confirmation that she was arrested.
So what did you do next once they confirmed that she was arrested?
Well, we were very concerned, and we were waiting for news, for information, and during several months, actually, we didn't get nothing. At the beginning, the Ministry of Foreign Affairs told us we are trying to locate them, to know where they are. So it's just a question of days or weeks, but we just, the time was passing by, months were passing by, and we didn't have any news, but they advised us to keep silent, to keep quiet. So we did so.
What was it like when you saw your sister and Jacques' forced confession on Iranian state media? We know the French government were outraged and released a statement, which I read in the monologue. What did you and your family do?
It was horrible. It was a terrible shock. It was a huge shock because, as I told you, we just went through 5 months, five long months without having any news from them. And the first time we had a sign of life, it was this video. It was a nightmare. It was very, very hard because we understood immediately what was going on. I read a lot of testimonies from other hostages, and I knew this was something. This was I knew things like that could happen to hostages and prisoners. So I immediately understood it was a false confession. She was forced to make it, and she was saying things at the opposite of her fundamental values. It was very, very hard because we were imagining all the psychological pressure she must have experienced to have to confess to make false confessions. So it was it broke us, literally it broke us. The day before, I got in touch with the daughter of another European hostage that you know, Naid Taghavi. So her daughter is Marianne Claren, and it was her who sent me the video, the link from the video, the morning of the 6th of October. And thanks to her, we could be informed of this false confession video a few hours before it was released in the French newspaper, French news. So it was great. It was a good thing for me and my family, because I could inform them and inform Jacques' family thanks to Mariam. And then after this false confession video, we decided to talk in the medias, because keeping silent didn't make any sense anymore, because they were exposed, and we needed to make a contact with my sister, because we didn't know how she was, and we were very, very scared, and we needed to tell her that we were fighting for her. We were worried about her, because we know the way of putting pressure on the hostages is telling them, you are alone. Nobody cares about you. Nobody is fighting for you, or nobody knows where you are. And it was very important for us to try to make a contact with my sister and to send her messages of support. So that's the first reason why we wanted to talk. Even if it was very illusional, I think, but we had to try. And also we needed to defend her, to defend her image, to mobilize people, to make them aware of the situation, to make them aware of the gravity of the situation my sister and Jacques were going through. And that's why the 22nd of November, we gave a press conference where we announced the creation of a support committee for my sister. And I don't know if it's a chance or what, but the day after my sister and Jacques had, the day after my sister had her first consular visit, first and only so far consular visit.
You're absolutely right. One of the things the interrogators try to do is convince the hostages that they're all alone, that people have forgotten them. I think Jason Rezaian, the Washington Post reporter, the American who was held hostage in Iran for 544 days, he was told by the interrogators that they told the family and everyone else that he and his wife, Yeganeh Rezaian, who was also held hostage, died in a car accident. And nobody's coming for you. Nobody knows you're here. So they try to break them. And it's very important for the hostages to know that they're not forgotten, that there's someone outside there fighting for their release. So you're absolutely right. You mentioned that you created this support committee for your sister and Jacques. Now, this support committee is something that's unique to France. I really like this concept. It's a group that campaigns for the hostages' release, but it's separate from the family in a way. In some cases, it's separate from the family, like Fariba Adelka, the French academic who's been held in Iran. There's a support committee for her. It's intentionally separate from the family. So if the French foreign ministry tries to put pressure on the family, or the hostage-taking state tries to put pressure on the family to keep quiet, they maintain this plausible deniability that, well, this is not our support committee, these are her colleagues and supporters and other people. So I really like this concept of a support committee that the French have. And I think it's worth exploring implementing this for other countries as well. You mentioned Mariam Claren. She is the daughter of German citizen Naït Taghavi, who's been held hostage in Iran since 16 October 2020. I interviewed her many times on this podcast and most recently a few weeks ago. So thank you for that. And I also understand why you kept quiet at the request of the French Foreign Ministry. Many families do this and they give the government a chance to secure the release of their loved one. And then after a few months, if they don't see any progress, or as you said, you saw them being forced to confess to something they didn't do, then you go public. That's kind of the standard procedure families follow, most of them. I know in Mariam's case, she went public immediately because she noticed what happened to the other hostages. So we understand that your sister has been held in solitary confinement. Can you tell us more about this? What are the conditions of a cell? Which prison is she being held in? And I note that you don't have all the information because you have limited contact with her. I know you've had one consular visit. The French government has been able to visit her once. But do you have any information on where she's being held and the conditions?
Solitary confinement was one of our biggest fears because I read it also in former hostages' testimonies that it was something that was very frequent. And during the first consular visit, and the only one so far, she told the ambassador that she had been held in solitary confinement for 3 months at least. And now we know she's in Evin prison. She is in the section 209. She has cellmates, two or three or four. It changes all the time. We know she can go out in the prison yard 3 times a week. We also know she had one book since she got arrested. So in 10 months, she had only one book. We know, that's what we know so far. We know she don't have many news from Jacques, and it's very hard for her. And, actually, it's very hard for us to have real accurate information because we had 2 phone calls with her from the beginning. So my parents got 2 phone calls with her. And during the 2 phone calls, she was under surveillance and she couldn't speak freely. And every time my father asked her about her condition of detention, she gave answer very unclear. So we don't have many details about what she's what she's living.
Again, I'm sorry to hear that. Do you have any idea how your sister is coping physically or mentally at the moment, either from the conversations you've had or what you've heard from the French officials who visited her?
She's very tired. The first time we had a phone call from her, she was crying almost all during all the call because I think it was very strong for her and for us to have this first phone call because it was the first contact we had with her in 7 months. So it was really, really strong. And the second phone call, she was very worried about my parents. So she made a great effort to reassure them about her health and how she was doing. But we can feel it's very difficult for her. It's very difficult. So I know she's a strong person. She's very tough. So we try to keep that in mind and to know that she's fighting and we are looking forward to having more news about her and more information and more accurate information.
Has your sister been able to speak to a lawyer? And if so, is this an independent lawyer or an Iranian regime appointed lawyer?
So far, as we know, she couldn't be reached by the lawyer we hired for her. So I think the answer is no.
Is your sister still awaiting trial at the moment?
Yes, and once again, we don't have any information about that. We don't know when, where it could happen.
Okay. I've interviewed many family members of hostages and wrongful detainees. Many of them go through the same trauma. This is one of the worst periods of their life. Feels like their life is on hold. Every time they wake up, they think about what they need to do today to free their loved one. And every day when they go to bed, they wonder if they did enough to free their loved one. They think about their loved one every time they eat. Is she getting enough food in prison? They stop spending time with friends. They feel guilty every time they rest. What is it like for you? How have you been coping with this trauma? And what has it been like for your family?
Our life has completely changed. It's not the same anymore. It's like if there were it's like if there was a lag between us and the rest of the people and the normal life. We don't have a normal life anymore. We are, as you say, we are thinking about it when we wake up, when we go to bed, every time of the day. We are always searching the news, the last news about Iran, several times a day. I didn't know Twitter before that, and now I'm always on Twitter. I'm passing my life, spending my life on Twitter because I'm always looking for something, some information. We are sad. We are afraid all the time. We don't know where she's sleeping, if she's sleeping on bed or something else. We don't know. We don't know what she is eating. It's very, very difficult for us, and she misses us so much. I don't know what I was. Yes, we weren't prepared to live something like this. I couldn't imagine I would have something so this hard to live one day. And I just want her to come back. It's very, I miss her so much. And yes, it's hard for me and my family.
I'm so sorry for you, your sister, and your family. The one silver lining, I guess, is that many families say an experience like this brings their family closer together and their love for each other becomes stronger as a result. Now, you have recently started campaigning publicly to free your sister. As you mentioned previously, you've created the support committee. Can you tell us more about what you've done so far on the campaigning front? Because I know you attended a rally with other families of French hostages in January. Can you tell us more about that and what else you've done on the campaigning front?
The idea of the rally was, when we created the support committee, we started to contact other families and committee and support committees. And, that's when we contacted, Blandine Brière and also, some people from the support committee of Fariba Adelkha. And together we started to organize this rally in Paris. It was very important for us because they were seven French hostages. And we knew if we were doing this together, it will be stronger and maybe more powerful. And that was very, very nice to organize because it's also created bonds between us. And there was a lot of people on this rally, so it was It was good for us, and the medias were interested also. So we had a good coverage, media coverage. We are willing to make, to organize other events like this, maybe on a European level with other European families. We are trying to organize all this stuff. It's quite difficult because everyone is struggling with its own situation, and we are trying to get on the same line. But yes, it's important for us. And on our side, we also try to put, banners in the city with picture of Cécile. We try to communicate every time we can in our region of origin, so Alsace, because we are from Alsace in France. We are trying to make a lot of local events. For example, this weekend we are organizing a weekend of concerts in our city of origin, and yes, things like that. And we have a website. We have to work better because for the moment it's quite quiet, and that's what we do.
That's very good. Good work doing that. Now, for our listeners, when Noémie mentioned this weekend, by the time this episode comes out, it will be last weekend.
Okay.
We're recording this 1 week prior to the episode being published. And you also mentioned Blandine Breer and the Free Fariba Support Committee. So on this podcast, we've interviewed Blandine Breer, who is the sister of French hostage in Iran, Benjamin Breer. He's been held since May 2020. He was recently acquitted of all charges, but he's still being imprisoned in Iran. And that just proves that he's a hostage. In terms of Fariba Adelka's case, she's a French academic who's been wrongfully imprisoned in Iran since 5th of June 2019. We've interviewed her colleague Sandrine Perrault on this podcast. She was recently released from Evin prison, but the circumstances of her release are not clear. We don't know if she can leave the country and come back home to France to be reunited with her family. So if you want to learn more about these cases, feel free to listen to these episodes wherever you get your podcasts or on our website at pothostagediplomacy.com. Now, Noémie, what should the Iranian regime do? I know in many cases, your pleas may fall on deaf ears, but what should they do?
To release all the hostages, but also ensure the rights of the hostages. For example, in the case of my sister, normally she should have one consular visit per month, and now she spent 10 months in jail and she only had one consular visit of 10 minutes under high surveillance too. She must have more contact with her families. For the moment, we had only two phone calls from her in 10 months. She must have books. For the moment, she has only one book, and we sent her a lot of books, so she might have them. She should have news from Jacques too. She should have some contacts with him. It's very important. And release her because she's innocent.
Now, what should the French government do?
Well, I'm not a diplomat or a politician, so they have to do what it takes to get the hostages free. I know they are working very hard for the hostages, but in the case of Benjamin, for example, he spent almost 3 years in prison. It's very long. It takes too long. And my sister almost 1 year, and it's too long. So to do whatever it takes to get the hostages free.
Now, what should the European Union do? Because you mentioned earlier that you may do an event with the families of other Europeans held hostage in Iran. So what should the European Union do?
Well, there are a lot of European hostages. So it's not only France's problem. It's also Germany, Austria, Spain, Sweden, and so on. And I think all these countries have weights. And if they are together, they are even stronger. So maybe work together to stop this hostage taking and take strong actions to solve the situation.
You're absolutely right. So I've seen members of the European Parliament put forward questions to the leadership of the European Union asking for a EU-wide approach to bringing hostages held in Iran back home. As you said, there are French hostages. So there's your sister Cécile and Jacques, Benjamin Brier, Farid Badalka, Louis Arnaud. We don't know who the other hostage is from France.
Did you say Bernard Fillon?
Bernard Fillon, who is the French-Irish hostage as well. Yes. And I know Britain isn't really in the EU anymore, but there's Mehran Raouf and Morat Tabaz from Britain. Morat Tabaz is both American and British. They're being held hostage in Iran too. In Germany, there is Naid Taghavi and Jamshid Shammad. Jamshid Shammad is a US resident. Jamshid was recently sentenced to death. In Austria, there's Kamran Gadiri and Masoud Mossaheb. In Sweden, there's Ahmad Reza Jalali. There's someone else as well. Forgive me, I don't know his name. And from Belgium, there's Olivier van der Castille. And I'm sure there are other hostages who have been taken. I know there's at least another Austrian hostage. It's a case that hasn't been made public. In Spain, yes, there's Santiago Sanchez. So there are many EU citizens held hostage in Iran. And even though I haven't said many names, the reason is other families tend to keep quiet. So these are the publicly known cases. And you're absolutely right. The European Union needs to work together because you'll have a lot more bargaining power, a lot more leverage over Iran. Now, you have been getting some good media coverage, but obviously the more media coverage you get, the better. It's important to keep her name in the media. This helps raise awareness of your sister's plight, and it keeps the pressure up on the French government to work to free your sister and the other hostages held in Iran. So what can journalists and news outlets do more to help?
Well, the help of journalists and media outlets is very, very important for us. So when they talk about the hostages, they are like, the only way we have to do something, to act as families and friends and support committee is communication. And thanks to journalists and media outlets, our voices are louder. So it's very important for us to get this help, and it's very nice because we are very scared as family to communicate, and when we start, we are terrified, and we think journalists will be, maybe seek information, and we will have to protect ourselves from that. And what I experienced, and many other family tell me they experienced the same, is that journalists are very, very nice, very understandable. They have many empathy for us, and their help is very thankful. We are very thankful of their help. So continue, keep telling our messages, and that's very important.
What can members of the public do to help bring your sister home?
Members of the public, you mean people in general?
Yeah, so if I live in France,
okay,
I am a regular French citizen. What can I do to help bring your sister home? I assume it would be writing to my politicians and asking them, what are you doing to bring Cécile Kohler and Jacques Paris home?
Yes, that's right.
yes. So what else can they do?
They can talk about the hostages, talk about my sister. They can share on social medias. They can join us for rallies, because the more we are, the more it's important. And yes, talk about it more and more, because it's very important that people is aware about this situation, about the gravity of this situation, and make people aware about this.
So if people want to get more information on your campaign and keep up to date with what you're doing, what's the best way for them to do that?
We, as I mentioned before, we have a website, libertepourcecile.com, and also a Twitter account, Liberté pour Cécile. So they can follow us, and we have some communiqué. I don't know how to say in English. So press release that we publish on the website. So they can have all the step of the situation of my sister from the creation of the support committee.
So for our listeners, if you check out the description of this podcast episode, wherever you're listening to it, if it's on our website or on your podcast app, we have a further information section where you can find the website address and the Twitter account URL as well. So feel free to check that out and follow, and you can get up-to-date information on the campaign to free Cécile. So Noémie, we're almost at the end of our interview. Is there anything else you'd like to mention?
Yes, I would like to thank all the people that helped us from the beginning, also all the people that send us support messages. It's very important for us. And also, I will especially thank all the people that that give me advice from the beginning. So families of other hostages, former hostages, journalists, and because we are lost, and we are in the dark, and all these persons are like little lanterns on the path. And that includes you, Darren, so thank you very much.
You're very welcome. It's an honor to help. So Noémie, we'll be campaigning right by your side until your sister comes back home. Thank you so much for taking the time to speak to us today.
Thank you.
Thank you for listening to Pod Hostage Diplomacy. Thank you for giving your time and for showing these families that they're not alone, that there are good, caring people out there willing to stand by their side and help in any way possible.
Because if enough people care, then the right people will care enough. This is sort of a basic rule of thumb that is true for all campaigning.
If you haven't already, please subscribe to our fortnightly newsletter called The Hostage Briefing. It's the best way to keep up to date with the cases we're working on, as well as new episodes. You can subscribe to this newsletter using the link in the description of this podcast episode that you're currently listening to. Thanks again, and take care.